I hope you to see what the central story is. And I won't read you the quote from Thomas Mann's The Magic Mountain. Mann is the first quote on the handout. But I want to read you the second, which is from Barbara Hieronymi, who's a living philosopher at the University of California, Los Angeles. Education must first stamp out citizens. The primary education inculcates the skills and knowledge students need to take their station in society as we know it, or be nice if it could not. Further education, higher education, must then undo this. My math teacher at school said, education is a process of diminishing deception. First we make you believe that this is true, and then we, once you get that on board, and we show you what's wrong with it, we slowly build that way. Because you have to start with simple pictures, and simple pictures are simplifications. Further education, higher education, must then undo this. It should provide students with the experiences, skill, knowledge, and perspective needed to step back from the ambient culture, the one that surrounds us, to gain critical distance from the forces that have shaped them, and to consider for themselves what to embrace, what to reject, what to improve. So that's what we're doing, right? We're stepping back from our moral inheritance, right? All these great thinkers who shaped our thought and the religious doctrines that have shaped it. We're trying to think critically about it. And so I want to take you back, not quite to the beginning, but almost to the beginning, which is the eight Beatitudes. Blessed are the poor in spirit, blessed are the meek. Right? And one of the things that struck us when we read that is that it seemed kind of strange that God would value, or appear to value, traits like meekness and poverty of spirit that we thought weren't that valuable at all. So the same with, it's harder for a rich person to enter the kingdom of heaven than for a camel to pass through the eye of a needle. You'd think all Christians would be busy giving their coat to somebody else, which of course might itself cause problems. But you just end up getting a coat that doesn't fit you after a while. I gave mine away and I got yours. But nonetheless, that's not what you see, right? Christians amass great wealth and seem to put a lot of value on it, even though the gospel apparently says God doesn't value it at all. And that, again, is a shocking sort of thought. It says, what God values and what we value. And what Nietzsche is going to do is explain to us how that came to seem, how that's intelligible. How we can make sense of somebody valuing that by telling a little story. And that's his strategy. So let's introduce the notion, which I'm very fond of. It's almost as much a favorite of mine as motivational set, which is epistemic engine. I know it sounds kind of fascinating or complicated, but really it's not. So, microscope, telescope. These are epistemic engines, right? They increase our knowledge. They're devices that increase our knowledge by increasing the scope of our perception. Before we had microscopes, we couldn't see very tiny things. I don't know if, when I was a kid, everybody had to have a microscope. I remember looking through it for the first time at a hair or some other things. And discovering that there is a massive world that's so tiny that we can't see it. Now we have electron microscopes. We can see even tinier and tinier things. Right? And as I say, if you're like Kant, you're in awe of the starry heavens above, it's a really good idea to look through a microscope. And notice that the non-starry heavens, the non-starry non-heavens below, are just as complicated and fascinating, even more so. But they're kind of chaotic and bizarre, unlike the sort of geometry. It's not geometry that you come away with, it's something else when you look at cells bubbling or something. So the microscope is one, the telescope is obviously another. Right now we have radio telescopes, we have very complicated telescopes. We can see far, far away into deep space, and we've discovered there's all kinds of stuff out there, like dark matter and other things that we'd never have known otherwise. So now here's somebody give you a nice, so notice these extend spatial scope. Right, they bring far off things close, they make small things visible. That's spatial, right? So what about time? Well, of course we've got vastly more sophisticated devices for measuring time. So, you know, somebody can now break the world speed record by 1 millionth of a second or something, right? And we've got clocks that can actually do that. And we even got clocks that tick only once a year. Not very helpful for most purposes, but nonetheless, making one that just ticks once a year is a very sophisticated piece of clock manufacturing. So we've got clocks, obviously, but notice that just helps us to measure time better, right? And what I want to look up, though, is, for example, computer simulation. Computer simulation, right, that allows us to do something like this. So, you know, just think when we think about, let me go with you, so a year, okay, 10, yeah, 100, yeah, 1,000, 10,000, 100,000, 1,000,000, 100,000,000, right, it starts to blur out, right? It's just a long time after a while, right? We can measure it, but our sense of what it is very diminished, right? Now, when we're told that we all evolved from slime or whatever the favorite thing is, right? And it took millions of years, our thought is, right, and most people's thought, how could I have evolved from slime or monkeys? Right. When people read Darwin, they weren't thinking, oh yeah, right, I thought that. Right, what they thought was, that's impossible, I'm not a damn monkey, right? And that was huge, and that's still, people have a lot of that sort of feeling that we couldn't have come from them. But one of the things that a computer simulation allows you to do is to do a temporal process that actually took hundreds of millions of years, but run it in the simulation. So you can actually see what very simple processes, like just filling in a cell on the screen or leaving it blank under a few minor conditions, can do by way of building incredibly complicated structures. So as a program, I encourage you to look at. Nothing beats actually seeing it, which is artificial life. And it's a program that can actually have runs, and you can see very complicated entities emerging from very simple ones over what in reality would be hundreds of millions of years, but in the computer it's just a few minutes. And so we know exactly what rules we program in. Nothing magic happens. It all happens according to a few simple rules in the program. Well, it's fascinating. You can see, for example, a big issue for ages was how do birds flock? How do they form flocks? How do fish form schools and move seamlessly around obstacles? And they thought it's immensely complicated. There must be some top-down, somebody's got a master plan, but it turns out that all you have to do is program a few simple rules into what you do if the next space is empty, what you do if it's full, and you get flocking and birds and all kinds of other fancy stuff. You can see all this happening. It's fascinating to watch. So the computer simulation allows us to do for is extend our temporal scope. That is, we can now see the effects of time in a way that we can't, because our eyes are adapted to the middle distance, relatively macroscopic objects like ourselves. That's what our epistemic apparatus, our internal epistemic engines, are all set for the local, the close, right? That's why, for example, it's much easier to bomb people from way up in the sky than it is to actually bludgeon them to death with a baseball bat. Well, you don't see anything. It's even better with drones. You just drive your car to downtown DC or whatever, and you go in an office building and you sit on a computer, you go, and you know, people die far away. You don't see the blood, guts, ooze, stuff. And in the same way, and that's a very important fact about our moral epistemic apparatus, which is it's much better adapted to the local, to our friends and family, the close ones to us, the tribe. And as we extend them, our concern for others, unless we artificially or intellectually extend it, gets less and less. Right? What happens to them isn't nearly as important as what happens to us. And that's a sad fact about us, but there's no alternative to emerge to live effectively in communities like ours and so on. And one of our issues is that now that the world has become global, a global community, we're faced with far greater complexity. A great example is the brown snakes in Hawaii. Well, there are no snakes in Hawaii. No snakes are indigenous to Hawaii, so none of the little animals, birds, and others have any snake fear. But brown snakes got into the undercarriages of planes in Guam and elsewhere, and got off in Hawaii, where they found lots to eat. Why? Well, because nothing there was afraid of them. So the bird would look at the snake and they would understand. And then the snake would eat the bird, right? Whereas in other places, right, the birds are suitably evolved to deal with snakes. So they run away when they see a snake. So, remember I told you, I think I told you this, maybe I didn't tell you, maybe I told somebody else. The blue-footed boobies, you know what they are? The blue-footed boobies are birds. Very cute. They court by showing their little blue feet to their mates. They go like this. Very sweet. You can Google them and see them actually do their little courtship dance. Anyway, the blue-footed boobies, they're called boobies. So the booby in British English is a stupid person. A booby is a fool, right? And they call them boobies because when they landed in Terra del Fuego, where these things are, right, the boobies had not evolved to fear big, ugly human beings who came at them and beat them to death with clubs just for the fun of it, because they were so stupid, as they thought. I kid you not. Who's stupid in that scenario? That's an interesting question. But as we learn about evolution, we stop thinking that way, right? Creatures adapt to survival locally. They may not be able to adapt well when things change. When, for example, people are riding ships who think that they're stupid for trusting stupid birds, they don't even run away when you come at them with a club. Look, bang, let's do another one. Right, okay, so see what happens? Right. Survival instincts, things that work very well, we all lived in nice little segregated tribes or nations, don't work very well when we're have international travel. Think about, for example, develop your immune system. You have an immune system adapted to the local, right? It works pretty well locally. But when you move elsewhere, right, your immune system may not be well adapted to all the pathogens that are there. That's what killed a lot of the American Indians when the white people came to America, and the same when the conquistadors came to South America. They brought influenza, cholera, and all kinds of other things that the natives weren't. I want you to think that way about your ethical system, too. Think of it as a kind of extension of your immune system that helps you to get on in the world and to handle various kinds of things, potential friends, potential enemies, and so forth. But that needs to be extended when what you face is vastly more complicated. So if you've grown up in an ethnically homogeneous, racially homogeneous, religiously homogeneous society of the sort, for example, that Aristotle was thinking about in Plato when they wrote, everybody would be Greek, you know, white. So if you think Greeks are white, myself, I think kind of a little browner than whiter. You know, I'm not interested in these guys. Just notice that hardly anybody is actually white, right? Nearly everybody is, well, kind of pink or gray or some other coloration, but not. not actually white. Okay, anyway, so this is white. And how many people do you know who are that color? If you found somebody who was that color, you'd be a little scared about their health. Okay, so you've got the picture? Yeah, and we could go on developing it this way. And then we would see that what we have to do with our inherited ethical system is we have to tweak it and extend it, change it, to better operate in a world that's quite different from the one in which it evolved. This is particularly difficult, I think, for religious-based systems to do, in part because they seem to be held in place by absolute demands, right? Coming from God and outside space and time. Okay, now what did I say about that? Well, because Nietzsche introduces us to an epistemic engine, one he invents, so to speak, and that's the notion of the genealogy. And that's an epistemic engine that extends our temporal. So what we're going to do is not ask this, am I to keep my promises? Will the meek inherit the earth? Is it good to be poor in spirit? But we're going to ask instead, how did those values, which we find mysterious, ever come to seem non-mysterious? How did they arrive on the scene? So where did meekness get its street cred from? Well, we can't see that. That's a mystery. It's a bit like, maybe there'd be a story about the crop of regrets. We don't have any idea what it is. So Nietzsche's going to do this for a few of the values, and then he's going to ask, how many of the values does it extend to? And the more values that it extends to, the more problematic, so to speak, those values become. So Nietzsche is a little bit like Thrasymachus. So Thrasymachus says, let me tell you a story about why you have the values that you have. And when I tell you the story, you'll see why you shouldn't just take them at face value. You shouldn't just assume that justice is a good thing or virtue is a good thing. You've been brought up to think that it is, but maybe it's like female chastity. Maybe it's one of those values that are just empty when you finally come to think about it, or a whole lot of other things that we might question. In Thrasymachus' case, the bottom line is there's a reason to be skeptical about those values. It's not that the skepticism is always justified. It's that the unskepticism is always unjustified. Just taking them at face value is never justified. But it might turn out that they pass muster. It might be that they're good. But you don't have to give a different argument for them then. That they're ours, right? And that's Nietzsche's line. So let's work through the handout together. It's very simple. To start with, and then it gets a little bit complicated, but not too complicated. Well, it gets kind of simple again. So here it is, the fable of the farmers and the blonde beasts. So I'm just going to read it, and we'll go through it and comment. Once upon a time, there was a happy agrarian community living in peace and harmony, planting their crops, plowing their fields, and enjoying the fruits of their labors. You might remember the city of pigs. There's a happy little agrarian group getting on with their lives, right? One day, out of the north, where all bad things come from, came a band of fierce warriors. They were bad too, but that's in the future. A band of fierce warriors who took over the agrarian community, turned the farmers into slaves, and lived at leisure and increasing luxury while the farmers did all the work and lived in abject poverty in miserable huts. They were able to do this because of their greater power and their willingness, or will, as Nietzsche calls it, to use it. It's a very simple story. It's happening in the world right now. Right? Simple people are being driven out of their houses and homes by men with guns, or being forced into slavery by men with guns. Right? It's a never-ending story, but this is the simple beginning of something. So the blonde beasts, now they're at leisure, right? They're not busy. You know, being a warrior and a band of raiding warriors is not fun. It's a lot of hard work. You've got to ride on horses. You've got a bunch of other men as your companions. And you've got to live out in the open. And often there's nothing. And then, you come across a happy little village with lots of cool stuff in it, and women. And what do you do? Well, what men do in those circumstances, regrettably, that's what happens. So now the blonde beasts are at leisure. They're no longer running around raping and pillaging. They've settled down into sort of established raping and pillaging, right? They don't need you to go out and do it anymore. They're domesticated at all. They nice, live in nice houses, and they've got nothing to do, so they reflect. Leisure, as Aristotle says, thinking begins with leisure. You've got to have some time taken away from satisfying your needs in order to do some reflecting. And the blonde beasts reflect on themselves and on their slaves. Look at us and how well off we are compared to them. We're the good kind of human beings to be. They're the bad kind. We're noble and beautiful. They're wretched and ugly. No one would want to be a slave. Everyone would want to be a master like us. We're the good. They're the bad, the poor, the miserable. We're the strong, the confident, the proud, the rich. They're the weak, the poor in spirit, the meek. Got it? Yeah. So what they do is they reflect, and when we reflect, we do exactly the same thing. We think, in a situation like that, which would you rather be, the master or the slave? And only the very noble or the very deranged would say, I don't want to be a slave. Right? Right? You want to live in a nice house. You want to have a nice car. You want to be able to get what you want, right? You want to have leisure so you can play music and have fun. Now emerges a great idea of Nietzsche's, one he loves, and so he keeps it in French, ressentiment, right? The emergence of ressentiment. Now we're going to look at how a psychological state emerges that wasn't there before. Once the farmers recover from their shock, they recall their old lives, see how the blonde beasts live, envy their luxurious leisure, which, by the way, they didn't have either before, right? Remember, you need slaves for luxury, and they weren't slaves. They had to work in the farms, but they enjoyed their own stuff. Hate them for what they've done and are doing, but are powerless to do anything about it. They can't change it, though they resent it. And this mix of envy, hatred, and powerlessness is resentment. Notice that it involves repression, since it can't be expressed or vented, not unvented. Not the world's worst. I've seen lots of others, but I'm pretty bound to them. Because my editors are always telling me, you're good at a lot of things, but you're a lousy proofreader. It's true. Since it cannot be expressed or vented in action. And so interiorization in its it's expressed or vented, the interiorization, it's being expressed or vented inside, and so of intensification. So think about it this way, right? You envy the blonde beasts, you hate them for what they've done to you, right? You're powerless to express that hatred in action, because if you do, they'll kill you, right? And it's that mix of powerlessness, hatred, and envy that make resentment. Right? So it's interiorized because you can't express it. So you have to think of a frustrated power bottled up inside you that you wish you could express, but you can't. So that's what intensifies it, right? It becomes intense because you can't vent it, right? Just the way that our anger does. So what happens is we resort, and this is a great Nietzschean move, I think, we resort to fantasy and imagination. So to compensate for the awful misery of their lives, in the evenings the slaves tell themselves stories to make themselves feel better. One day a great hero will come who's on our side, and he will overthrow the blonde beasts and make us the masters. Then we will get our revenge and treat them the way they treat us. Fantasy, with all its emotional components, is an effect of interiorization and manifests intensification consequent on repression. The inner life becomes the place where non-alienated activity, non-enslaved activity takes place. So as the thought is, they can't enslave my imagination. Right? There's at least a place where we're free to do what we want, namely in our imagination. And those imaginations are not simply individual or social. We gather together initially to talk about our lot, to express our emotions among ourselves, right, to tell ourselves stories about one, how one day our prince will come, so to speak, or our hero, and fix it. You with me? Sounds pretty simple, doesn't it? I think so. It's just a lot of very simple steps, but it takes a kind of genius to see them all in a kind of order. So what happens next is the strengthening of the imagination. So just think about the imagination as a muscle. If you don't use it, it doesn't get good. But if you do use it, it gets better and better. So you become better and better at being able to about tell stories, put together long chains of episodes in a long narrative, right? To be able to write the Iliad or the Odyssey or write a poem or a piece of music or whatever. Over time, the stories become more elaborate. Great stories are remembered, passed on to others. Those that use rhyme and rhythm do better in this regard, especially if they can be sung or chanted. So maybe it's an oral culture or writing that has to be passed on, like the Iliad and the Odyssey. Music and dancing develop to help with this task. And all of this develops the minds of the slaves, just as their hard work, not hard work, their hard work develops their muscles and their coordination. But it also involves social practices of teaching, learning, and acquired skills and disciplines, right? You have to, the bard, the one who is good at remembering it, becomes the one who is the repository of the stories, has to pass them on to a new generation. Other people remember them and learn them. Just think how easy it is, how quickly we learn a pop song or a new song when we hear it, and how quickly it becomes part of memory. Already so far? See what's happening, right? Right, one space, the physical space that the master is controlling, as being having added to it another space, which they don't control, the space of the imagination, of fantasy, of story, and it's there that the slaves are getting stronger, right? Because they're putting a lot of their own creative energies into these stories, since they can't put them into anything else. Everything else is alienated. So the farmers now reflect on themselves and their masters. They call us bad on themselves. Good. As we do, as we say, we're the wretched, they're the well-off, they're the successful ones, we're the failures. We share this. That's part of the envy, right? We want to be them. So we see that it's better to be them than us. We agree about this. They're the good, we're the bad. But there's something wrong with the world. We're oppressed slaves, and they're oppressing us and making us suffer. To express what's wrong with the world, let's say that the masters are evil. What makes the masters good, though, is that they have power on their side. They're strong enough to take what they want. But our great hero is stronger, the one we've imagined, is stronger than they are, and he's on our side. So we're the ones who are really good. Now, notice the shift. Right? First, I share the values of the masters. They're the good, we're the bad. But there's something wrong with the world. They're oppressors. Right? We're oppressed. To express what's wrong with it, let's introduce a new term. Let's call the masters evil. It has no comment. Just that's what we're going to call them. And now when we think about the great hero who will come and liberate us, who's on our side, and who shares our perception of the masters, he will say that they're evil and we're good. So we go from this situation. Notice that this is the world turned upside down. So think about it this way, right? When the slaves look at the world, they think it isn't the right way up. They should be the masters, and the masters should be the slaves. That's what the envy says. Right? So in fantasy, they invert the world. They, in fantasy, they turn it on for Nietzsche to show us how the inversion works. He says, call the old masters, the really good, the previously good, call them evil, and the previously bad, call them good. So that's the crucial first step. Notice the role that fantasy plays in it. Right? This is all happening inside the heads of the slaves. And nothing in reality is changing. They're still slaves. The masters are masters. But in their fantasy world, right, they want to say, when our hero comes, who's on our side, he changes the world around. He'll have a negative attitude to the masters. He'll say they're evil. Right? They're the ones that are wrong or bad. And we're the ones who are. Yeah.
Did I hear when you said we just call them evil and it doesn't have any, like it doesn't have content. Do you mean like it's a summary style, not reductive?
Yeah. As the thought is, it's just what reflects what's wrong with them, right? From our fantasy point of view. What's wrong with them from that as well? They're oppressing us and so on, right? But it doesn't change our, remember, this is all still taking place inside the mind of the envious slave. So the first step in the revaluation of values, in reality, the masters are still good and the slaves are still bad. But in the fantasy world of song and story, the masters are evil and the slaves are good. So just imagine what the song might be like, right? And along came our great hero, and our great hero said, those masters are evil. I'm going to destroy them, I'm going to make them the slaves, I'm going to make you the masters. It's to reflect that switch, right, that we need the new terminology. So what happens, so that's the first step in the revaluation of values. That's all about the slaves and their imaginations and their developing of a culture of imagination, strengthening their minds and imaginations in order in the process. So the first thing you should think about with Nietzsche is your mind is like your immune system. You don't just get it. It has to develop. It has to develop in a long story that explains why it's got the resources that it does now. Right? It didn't just pop out of the sky, God put it in you, all made up already. No, it had to emerge from more primitive minds. Right? And so that's the first step in the revaluation of values. Is everybody clear about it? Though it's subtle, so you have to just look at all the phases of it. Make sure you get the resentment stuff, the interiorization, the intensification side of it, the fantasy side. Now we shift over to the blonde beasts. I'm talking about the slaves. What's happening over in the big house? Well, here's what's happening. There's an emergence of what nature thinks of as decadence. The blonde beasts are warriors, strong, courageous, tested in battle. They're hard men, as we say. But now they don't need to fight anymore. They eat, drink, make love to the pretty daughters of slaves, grow fat and lazy. Their children, born to a life of luxury and leisure, become ever more decadent. It's a story we all know, which is that when mom and dad, hard-tack lives, they had to struggle to make every penny. But now they've got it. They want a better life for you, so they don't want you to struggle. They want to make it easy for you. What happens when things are made easy for you? Well, you get decadent. Right? So if you just think of it physically, you're not in very good condition. Well, you don't have to go out and struggle athletically. You don't have to make a life for yourself with your sword. You don't have to travel on horseback. You don't have to do all that hard stuff. You just get to sit at home and live a life of leisure. And what happens? Well, you don't develop big hard muscles. You get a little soft, right? You're much more interested in doing other things than going out, right? You start thinking, those warriors are kind of crude, aren't they? Dad, do we have to have them over every damn night? All they do is, get drunk, belch, and talk about great power. Like old athletes. Right? That's what they are. Now they're fat old athletes, remembering their past athletic successes, but kind of almost unable to get out of the chair. Right? And the children, this continues, right? The decadent children have even more decadent children as they become more luxurious and more used to a life of luxury and more valuing of it. Right? When dad says, you know what the greatest thing in life is, to go out there and kill your enemy with your sword? They think, no, that's much better to sit at home and listen to music and have the slave girls come and bring you good stuff and sing songs and hang out and wear nice clothes.
They're about to
armor is so heavy. And the horses, it really hurts after a while, you know. It's much nicer to lie around. That's the thought. That's decadence. The masters alienate more and more onto the slaves. This is the increasing decadence. As the masters become more indecadent, they involve the slaves in more and more aspects of their lives. Initially, the slaves worked the fields and did the hard physical labors, but were kept out of the master's quarters. Then household slaves, more delicate, more refined, less brutalized, became commonplace. Then slave nannies and wet nurses were employed to spare the master's wives from having to do these demanding tasks. They put their young charges to sleep. Now, what's up there? Phase one, right, is that the slaves initially do just what they did before the masters arrived. They farmed, right, worked outside, did all that stuff. But then it's sort of like, darling, do you want to cook dinner tonight? No. Let's get a slave to do it. Well, can't you teach the slave how to do it? Then we won't have to do it again ever. No restaurants yet, right? Oh, get the slaves in, get some of them to cook. What about cleaning up after dinner? Oh, man, I hate that. No dishwasher. Get a slave to do it. What about cleaning the house? Get a slave to... But those slaves out there, they're so violent. I fear having them in the house. You never know what they're going to do. Train the girls, get them young, right? Bring them in, make them nice. So they'll be fine. You know, they'll be okay to have around. We won't have to worry about them. Bring them in, right? See how it goes? Very simple. What about slave children? You know, if I have to teach that kid how to do simple arithmetic one more day, I'm going to take my sword and cut his damn head off. Can't you get a slave to teach the damn children? Duh. What about nursing a baby? Oh, God, that's such a pain. Why have to get up in the middle of the night? What about changing it? Okay, give it to the slaves, right? That's how it goes. If you watch, there are lots of good Hollywood movies that have thoughts exactly like this, right, in which people get rich and then they have personal assistants. There was a great name for them, what they call it. I can't remember. It'll come to me in a second. Something like the task whore. Give it to the task whore. That's a disparaging term, of course, but the thought is alienated. Who wants to go shopping? Who wants to go deal with the appointments? Give it to somebody that you're paying for. Right? To put the young charges to sleep, the nannies sing them songs. Well, what songs? Well, the songs the nannies know. And what songs are those? Well, slave songs. Affectionate bonds develop between nannies and children, since nanny, not mother, was the primary caregiver. The effect on the later emotional lives of these future masters is latent power that will eventually find expression. We'll talk about that in a second. Noticing that some of the slaves seem especially intelligent, those who have developed their minds and imaginations through storytelling and music, the masters have them taught to read and write so that they can become estate managers and bookkeepers. Then they have some sent to school so that they can become tutors to their sons. They do all this because their own value system as warriors, though now a bit decadent and mutilated, leads them to set a low value on such things. They don't want to manage their own estates or teach their sons to read and write. They want to hunt, dance, woo fair damsels, feast with their friends, and show off their wealth. So a very simple story. So notice two elements of it. One is the affectionate bond between the children and the nanny, and the acculturation of the children by the nanny. So nanny tells stories, and you can imagine, here's a little, nanny says, once we were free, happy farmers, then these awful warriors came and enslaved us. And the little kid says, who were those awful warriors? Why did they do that to you, Nanny? I don't like that. That was your dad. That was Daddy that came and enslaved. I'm making it crude, but you see how it goes, right? The children start to identify with and feel affection for the slaves that take care of them. And as a result, right there, those bonds of love and friendship are growing well, an infection, are potent forces that will turn out to be very good. Notice, too, that the warriors, because they are warriors, don't put a very high value on learning and education and doing the and teaching. They want somebody else to do that for them. As a result, they're not getting good at it. So, you know, every 18th century comedy, right, if we think of The Marriage of Figaro, right, it's about the clever servant who can outwit the dumb master, because the master doesn't know how to keep the books, right? Now, as soon as you gain a skill, you gain a power that then you can utilize, right? And that becomes a standard of plots, right, of plays in which the servants are actually the really clever ones. We can go all the way to P.G. Woodhouse and Bertie Wooster and Jeeves, the butler, who is so much smarter than Ben Wooster that the whole comedy relies on just how smart the butler is and how dumb the master is. The slaves grow ever smarter and the masters ever more decadent. All that education, all that increased intellectual practice involving reading, bookkeeping, buying and selling, bargaining, makes the slaves smarter, cleverer, better at arguing, better at finding ways to outwit their masters. It increases their power and their will to use them. The masters, by contrast, do less and less to keep their minds sharp and their warrior abilities battle-ready. Right? They decline on two fronts. Since they're not fighting anymore, they've stopped being really good at it. They're not eager to go on campaign. What a bore. Right? They don't want to do that. And at the same time, they're not busy improving their minds either. They're enjoying the fat of the land. They're sitting around eating and drinking and listening to music and doing other stuff and maybe occasionally going to hunt a boar or whatever else about. The second step in the revaluation of value. See with me so far? See what's happening? Increased abilities of a new kind, namely intellectual ones, growing out of fantasy in a perfectly understandable way, have made the slaves better at something. It's becoming more important than the warriors of spring. Meanwhile, the warriors are becoming decadent and their children even more so. So the second step in the revaluation of values, the tutors teach their young charges about values, about justice, injustice, but they teach them philosophy. Right? They start saying, you know, well, what do you think? Suppose you had You were playing with your little marbles out there in the schoolyard, and a big guy came and took your marbles away. But you like that? No. What are we going to call that? Let's say that it's unjust when that happens, right? It's bad, isn't it? You don't like it, do you, right? Stuff like that. Stuff we've been doing, in other words, that kind of thing. Right? Already predisposed to listen by the songs they learn from their nannies and by their emotional attachment to their nannies. The young masters are willing pupils. It's not just the intellectual stuff. It's that accords with their feelings and their sense of the world. They think, yes, right, this shouldn't happen to someone I care about. Right? That's the love. When they hear about the hard lives of the slaves, about how they used to own their land and work for themselves, but then were enslaved, whipped, raped, brutalized by grand beasts, they see these things as evil. They see them as wrong. And that's because of these collective forces, some intellectual, some emotional. Their beloved nannies whipped and raped, their slave friends apt to be sold to harsh masters, they feel the same horror, the same feeling that these things are unjust and evil as their tutors do. Where's my friend? Where's Nanny? I sold her. I beat her to death. These are going to have different effects on the young who have attachments to these people than they are to the masters who have no attachments. Less inclined emotionally to argue against them, they are in any case less well equipped intellectually to do so. The children are not as smart and well educated as the tutors, and therefore the tutors are in a position to give them arguments that they won't be able to deal with. So they're emotionally set to go in that way, and they're intellectually, right, They see the authority of the masters and no more on that subject. At night, they hear again and sing quietly to themselves the powerful and moving songs that sent them to sleep as infants. Go down, Moses, way down in Egypt land. Tell old Pharaoh, let my people go. When Israel was in Egypt land, let my people go. Oppressed so hard they could not stand, let my people go. Thus spake the Lord, bold Moses said, if not, I'll smite your firstborn dead. I like those right in there. Let my people go. He dreams of the great, you can look at the whole set of these great slave songs. Wow. But what I want to do is say, look, this is, when we think about jazz and the blues, we're thinking about music that started in this context. We're starting about the suffering of people expressed in imagination as compensation in part for the terrible lives they live. Just as we turn on the television or read a novel or go to a film to be distracted from lives that are much less bad than the slaves' lives. And we spend a lot of time, one of the biggest businesses in the world is the entertainment business. It's not play. Entertainment is necessary to help us to compensate for a world that would be intolerable if we didn't do it. In the same way, intoxicants and narcotics present in almost every culture are there in part to make it bearable, right, that we live as we do. And that's a very important fact about us. So Nietzsche says, art exists so that the bow won't break. It's that we need it. And great art, of course, does other things besides that, but that's part of what we want art for, is to entertain us, take us away from where we are, take us into a fairyland where things are easier, better, more pleasant, so we don't have to deal with the world around us. He dreams of the great hero who will free the slaves, turn the world upside down, and set it straight. That is, put it in accord with the values he now feels to be the true ones in which the masters are evil. He imagines how much his nanny would love him for that, how proud his tutor would be, how he would be free to marry his tutor's beautiful daughter, who would otherwise be sold or used for the sexual pleasure of his father's friends. At this point, the values of the slaves have gained a foothold in the imagination of the future masters. Like a virus infecting an immune system, not able to resist it. In this case, we might need a good virus, but a virus right that is like, oh. I'm thinking of Pink Floyd's The Wall. Right. the lyrics are escaping me temporarily. I'll come back in a second. Hey, teacher, leave those kids alone. We don't need no education. We don't need no thought control. No dark sarcasm in the classroom. Teacher, leave those kids alone. Hey, teacher, leave those kids alone. As the thought is, when the kids go to school, the kids of the masters go to school, the slaves infect them with slave values that the students are ready to accept because the feelings they have already go along with them and because the teachers are smarter and better able to articulate the values. Right? So when we think about Nietzsche, we think about Thrasymachus, he has the same strategies in mind. This is how you get your values. You get them by being taught them in certain kinds of social contexts. That doesn't mean they're good values, it just means this is how you got them. And what we have to do then is ask whether we got good ones or not. But we can't answer that by simply saying, well, they're ours, right? Because we see how we would get them. So from the point of view of the slaves, the students are being improved, they're getting better values. But from the point of view of their masters, right, the masters, they're getting worse values. Right? Why? Well, because from the slave's point of view, the masters are evil. But from the master's point of view, the masters are good, right? That's the picture. So the third step in the revaluation of values The young master inherits his father's estate and all his wealth and power. He has money, social position and status. He's well educated, knows how to argue well and speak persuasively. He emancipates his own slaves and encourages other masters to do the same. He talks about the evils of slavery, its injustices and cruelties. At this point, the values of the slaves have gained a foothold in reality, not just in the fantasies of anybody or anybody's mind, because power of one sort and power of another have joined forces. Right? So when the decadent son of the master finally inherits the father's estate and all the arms that go along with it and all the social position and all of the power that goes along with it, two kinds of power. Slave intellectual power and master force of arms have joined together. And that's what's crucial for values to work in reality. Christianity took over the West because it joined with the Roman Empire, which already had lots and lots of arms. It didn't just happen by a kind of miracle. At this point, as I say, the values have gained a foothold in reality because of those two kinds of power going together. So, momentarily cutting a long story short, eventually, many generations later, the young master's great-great-grandson, now the commander-in-chief of his nation's army and navy, issues the Emancipation Proclamation. That on the first day of January, in the year of our Lord 1863, all persons held as slaves within any state or designated part of a state, the people whereof shall then be in rebellion against the United States, shall be then, thenceforth, and forever free. And the executive government of the United States, including the military and naval authority thereof, will recognize and maintain the freedom of such persons, and will do no act or acts to repress such persons, or any of them, in any efforts they may make for their actual freedom. Now, that's how it got started on Nietzsche's view. Started by taking over the imaginations of children and ended by taking over the world. So let's cut in the story. Sure. So notice the elements in the story, right? Reflections and implications. There's no magic in the story. No hand of God, no miracles, no nothing. It's all straightforward explanation in terms of causes and powers. There are no magical forces. And it's clear, it's clever how it operates, but it doesn't take much once you see it to understand, but it makes perfect sense, as we'd say. In it, this is from Charles, a quantum of force is just such a quantum of drive, will, action. In fact, it's nothing but this driving, willing, and acting. And only the seduction of language and the fundamental errors of reason petrified within it, which construes and misconstrues all actions as conditional upon an agency, a subject can make it appear otherwise. What does that mean? Well, it just means this, that the agents in operation in the story, that the causal forces, are not personal. They're not persons liberating the slaves. They're forces within the minds and the bodies of people, expressing themselves in the best way they can. So, right, it's not this. The slaves don't think. Let's develop a really good imagination because that will help us develop a mind. They're going to become decadent. We're going to become clever. Nobody's doing that. All that's happening is that, so a response to painful situations leads to a fantasy thing. That leads to this, that leads to this, that leads. It's all just, as Nietzsche would say, determined, causal. There are no free wills involved. Nobody is sort of thinking, as an act of free will, right, or because the categorical imperative demands of, I'm going to, no, nothing like that happens, right? That's the story. So how a revaluation of values, a change in the value of values occurs. Remember, Nietzsche says the book is all about the value of moral values, right? So this is about how the change occurs. Within the story, we see and fully understand how a revaluation of values occurs. Good, bad is replaced by good, evil. The previously good become evil, the previously bad become good. We see this first occur in a fantasy imagination inspired by and fueled by resentment. A resentment then we see the current reality, so that in it, resentment becomes genuinely creative of values. That force, that's what started it all. The bottling up of a mix of envy and powerlessness is what drove that whole machine. Right? Now we see how it can, how resentment can actually create values. And now also new power relations and new men, new human beings are created. At the time, we see how one kind of power, military power, physical strength, gets conjoined with, while nonetheless being subordinate to, another kind of power, the power of thought. Right? We see the slaves developing their power of thought, but still subordinate to the military power of the masters who can still kill them. The warrior gives way to the thinker. Right? The power of thought overcomes the power of the initial power of the warriors by co-opting the military power of the young who inherit. That's a brilliant bit of thinking, I think. When Descartes says, cogito ergo sum, res cogitans, I think ever and ever I'm a thinking thing, he thinks he's expressing a timeless truth. We are essentially, and have so have always been, thinking things. That is to say, beings for whom thinking has always been the essential thing, the most important thing, the quintessentially human thing. The story suggests otherwise. Thinkers is what we became because of the slaves' revolt and morality, as Nietzsche calls it. Right? Thinking became important, not because it was always important, or because God made us thinkers, or because that's our essence, but because of the story I just told you about how thinking got its power in the world. Right? So when we start talking these days about we've entered the information age, right? A big part of what we're thinking is that almost all the major battles are battles that are going on in this new realm. Right? So the greatest theft in human history, allegedly, right, is when our computers were the codes were broken by the Chinese, who entered all of them and stole all the patents we have. Right? They didn't have to do all that research themselves anymore, allegedly so. But the newspapers tell me they didn't have to do all that research themselves anymore. They just got clever enough to steal it. Well, more power to them, you might say. In fact, more power they have, right? Because that's just what things happen. When the Russians allegedly influenced our last presidential election, they didn't do it by coming in with an army, right? They just got some bots and a whole lot of stuff on Facebook and set about doing some other stuff. And of course, almost everything was controlled by computers that are, right, not tanks or anything else, but information machines. It's better to be clever. So it's curious that when we all recognize that, that we should now be living in a time when the most powerful country in the world is busy repressing knowledge and putting, you know, so the president, as you know, has refused to meet the Nobel Prize winners for the first time. Because it just doesn't think that science is that important. Well, when the slave owners thought that, thought science wasn't that important either, they kind of lived to regret it, as we all know that knowledge is power. So, the story suggests we are unknown to ourselves, as the opening sentence. We know ours, and with good reason. We've never looked for ourselves. So how are we supposed to find ourselves? That's the looking that we just did in the story that reveals what we really are. Not that we were always and ever thinkers, but that we became them. And I think it's very important to say that this is not an inevitable story. This is just a story that happened. It's not one that had to happen, right? It's not one that can't be reversed. So here's my little fantasy. When I'm in a good mood, I play it one way. When I'm in a bad mood, I play it the other way. So here's the bad version. A virus emerges and it attacks and kills everybody with an IQ over 60 or whatever. Right? Just so happens that it does. Or everybody who's got a PhD in physics or chemistry or any science, right, just selectively bumps them all off. And you're left, what happens? Well, the world takes a massive drop in how important knowledge and science is. Why? Well, because there's nobody to have it anymore to read the books or understand them or pass it on or whatever. The other version is that, you know, the virus just kills off all of the people you would rather live somewhere else, leaving behind only us. Think how nice that would be, like heaven really in a kind of way. But you know what would happen, though? The same process would start, right? Yeah, I have to get a PhD in physics, but darling, you don't have to get one because, you see, I made so much money. You can just relax. I bet you a sports car. Why don't you just kick back for a while? I don't know. Go to Hawaii. Negatives. It's never something that we can get rid of. Always perennially there. When the temptations arise to give in to our least good traits, we tend to do it. So let's revisit the Gospel of Matthew. When the slaves became good in the fantasy of the great hero and the master's evil, something else happens. First, the traits of slaves, humility, turning the other cheek, meekness, poverty of spirit, real poverty, become good traits. It's good to be like that. Master slaves are good, master is evil. Second, the traits of masters, power, wealth, indulgence and appetite, pride, prestige, become evil, negative. It's evil to be like that. Weeks ago, we asked, why does the Christian God have the strange values he has? Why does he value poverty of spirit, meekness, and actual poverty? Why does he dislike wealth, power, success, and spiritualness? Why, in its later developments, is Christianity so worried, not worries, about sex, that it sees celibacy as the preferred condition? St. Paul. Call the great hero the Christian God, and we have an answer. God has these values because he's the God of slaves, who became our God, the real God, because of the success of the slaves' revolt in morality.
Brilliant.
Philip and Alan. I'm not saying it's true. It's just brilliant, right, to say, I can tell you a story about these that makes them intelligible. Don't yet jump to the conclusion that at the end of the day, these values are all going to turn out to be bad. Don't jump to that. This is simply how we got them. It's not telling us yet what their value is, right? And in fact, in the third essay, Nietzsche will spring a great surprise on all of us. After all, remember that among the slaves' values are the values of thinking and knowledge and all of those things that we do think are valuable. So we can't just say this, oh, damn, slaves' values, get rid of them. No. This can be an engine of discovery just as much of good values as it can be an undercutting of bad ones. That's the problem that people have. I think if you read Nietzsche shallowly, you come to the conclusion that he's a nihilist, he has no values, he's anti-Christian, he has all of these other things. But if you see that, that's just to provoke you, to get you to see that, you know, there's a challenge. But then when you read more carefully, you see that Nietzsche also thinks less than he himself, as a professor of philology, for goodness sake, right, is himself the downstream inheritor of all of these values, and he certainly doesn't think there's anything wrong with science or knowledge or truth or any of these other things. So we have to be careful. We're just getting a story about how we got them and about that helps us to understand their peculiarities. We're not yet being told which ones we ought to get rid of and which ones we ought to keep. Now we can revisit the book of Job. The perfection and uprightness, the justice, to call it that, that God values in Job as something intrinsically valuable, something he rewards only when it's valued for its own sake, is put in question. The value of such a value is put in question by this story. Why? Because it's the value of a God of slaves. The fact that the embodiment of slavish values finds something intrinsically valuable is not a reason to think that it is intrinsically valuable. In fact, it's a reason to think that it isn't intrinsically valuable. But it's only a reason. Other considerations may outweigh it. In turning the world of value upside down, the slave's revolt may have hidden some values and distorted others, but it may also have revealed some new and quite genuine values. So, right, when we see that God values something in Job, when we see that the God who does that is the God of slaves, we have a reason to ask, should we value what the God of slaves values? We don't have an answer to the question. We have a question and a way of thinking about the perfection of uprightness, that renders it non-mysterious. What God values in Job is intelligible in the story, right? The story makes it intelligible that he should value it. That doesn't tell us that he correctly values it. It just helps us to understand what he does. Take another little step. I think we have time. We'll come back to luxuriate.